Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for coming. We have a real treat for you today. I'll just put this beer down before I drop it. Oh, apologies for the attire. I'm a little bit under the weather. These are the warmest clothes I own.
Okay, so
not much sympathy in those. Oh, yeah. Right. It's a real honour to have this guest here. We've been trying for a long, long time to get him, and it's a pleasure for me to be asking him the questions, because this is without doubt the best winger I ever played with, and one of the best footballers to ever play for Reading. Created a lot of goals for me, and probably a lot of happy memories for you guys as well, and a few of those memories we'll talk about tonight. So we're just going to watch a video of the great man before I introduce him up here. So enjoy this.
I think I'll sit down actually.
Yeah. Oh. Ladies and gentlemen, the legend, Glen Little.
Thanks, kids. Yeah. Thanks, everyone. Yeah.
Do you know how many people have said to me, you'll only have to ask him one question and then you won't have to say anything else?
Yeah. Do you know what? I've just said to Kitson before, the 106 legend, and we might have to milk this for about 4 months because I'm a bit worried about Leicester.
We had Leeds here the other day, Leroy Leeds, and he was cool as a cucumber. He was like, nah, it'd be fine. They've only got to lose 3 more games. The problem with that is they haven't lost for about 4 years.
No, I had it last season because when I've been doing the commentary for, I do BBC Berkshire and BBC Lancashire from the old club Burnley, and last season Burnley were just on a roll, kids, and I thought they're going to do it. And then just towards the end, Vincent Kompany made a few changes towards the end where they won the league, I think with 5 games to go, and he let us off the hook a bit. So we got away with it then, but then just seeing the Championship this season, I don't know about everyone else, it just seems to just get worse and worse. And those teams that came down, they're just so much stronger. And when you think Leicester, they've lost the Barnes and Madison, yeah. Tillemans. Could you imagine what would happen if they had them? But now I'm even more worried with Leicester than I was with Burnley.
Yeah, I think you always get one exceptional team that you think, maybe a couple, but it's like a couple used to say, the cream always rises to the top. But the Championship for me is it's the one league that lulls you, like players like us, into thinking that we can probably stick our boots back on. And then I watch Man City Spurs the other day and think, Jesus, how fast is that? It's unbelievable where it's going.
It's just the gulf now with the Premier League now, and I saw so much of Burnley last season in the Championship, and I said in October, they'll run away with this. It's such a poor league, and they did. What helped with Burnley? They got to a slow start. They made a lot of changes. Vincent Kompany, new manager. So those first sort of 12, 13 games, they had a lot of draws they should have won, and then they took off. And so we got lucky there getting away with it, but Leicester, they haven't had the slow start. They lost players, and yet they started well. They've kept it going. Just maybe the last couple of results, when they lost at Coventry, got the draw the last minute against Ipswich. So maybe a bit of hope, but no, I just think they're so much stronger. You've seen Southampton. They're sort of similar to what Burnley did. Slow start, new manager coming in. Now all of a sudden, some new players. They lost Ward-Prowse and Tello, who was fantastic for Burnley last season. Again, if they'd have had them, if they hadn't lost players, look what they'd be doing. But the three teams that come down, they might all go up, and the three that went up could all come down. That's never happened before. Yeah. No, never happened. And usually you get teams like, even from our day, kids, we went up and did well in the first season. Sheffield United a few years ago, they went up and surprised people. I think Wolves as well, they had a really good team in the Championship. And then, but now the three teams, it's not the fact that they might go down, they can hardly win a game between them.
Yeah, no, that's true. It is pretty poor. I'm surprised at that, because I thought they might, you closer obviously too than me, but I was expecting a little bit more, I have to say.
Well, the problem they had is they made a lot of changes last season and had some good loans, which really helped. With Teller was one of the best players in the Championship last season. I thought Harwood Bellis came in, did really well. Matson from Chelsea, they didn't get him back. And then they've made a lot of other changes. They just haven't coped with it. They've got a young team and they got off to a bad start. And we know, kids, don't we, that from our time, how important that start is.
Yeah.
And that we'll probably go over our first season in the Premier League. The fixture list don't half help.
Yeah.
And when we had Middlesbrough, you had Villa, I think, Wigan early on, and Man City, aren't the Man City.
We did
the double over Man City, didn't we? And yeah, it sounds ridiculous talking about that now. But we were able to get off to a decent start, had some points in the bag, so that when we did have a tough start, I think we had a run with, we had Liverpool at Anfield, we had Portsmouth at Fratton, and Arsenal, Chelsea, the Peter Cech game when he got hurt. And it was that like, was okay, we had a wobble. Well, he got booted in the head, he got kneed in the head from our mate Hunty.
Yeah.
But we had a bit of a dip, it was like, we had some tough fixtures. I remember Arsenal, that was a going over. We could never do Arsenal, could we? There was just something about, like Manchester United gave them a game, Chelsea, Liverpool, we had some good results, but just that Arsenal, we tried all different kickoffs. We tried the Sunday, Super Sunday, we had them on a Monday night, we had them on a Saturday morning. It didn't matter. The hardest team to play against. And even though that was probably Arsene Wenger to a T, wasn't it, where Arsenal just, the game up that stands out with me, that it was the only time in my career I felt just so inferior and embarrassed, really. I didn't feel... We drew 2-2 at Stamford Bridge, probably one of the best games that I never won. That first time Reading had ever been at Stamford Bridge, 2-2. And the Manchester United, we drew 1-1 at Old Trafford, we drew 0-0 at Old Trafford when you got sent off, kids.
I don't know.
And so, there was the win against Liverpool, Harps, that great goal, and Harps burst through and scored a 3-1 win against Tottenham, but it was just Arsenal. You actually felt when you played Chelsea, and at least you had their respect. They had that sort of contingent, didn't they, with John Terry, like Frank Lampard, those English boys, that they gave you respect. You felt, okay, we know we're up against it, but if we can maybe sort of frustrate them and have a good game plan, we might be able to get a result. Arsenal, I just felt they looked at you as if, what you're even doing on the same pitch. So foreign players. And the game at the Emirates, first time, I think I had 3 touches in the whole of the first half. And I remember walking off, how is this 0-0?
Yeah.
Just, I've had 3 touches. You'd get the ball, you'd look up, where's Kitts? You're over on the left wing because you're doing doggies. There's no one up front. I'm looking, City and Arps don't want the ball because as soon as you give it to them, they're going to get taken off them. And you know, if I try a little in ball and give it away on the edge of the box, then it's going to be in the back of the goal. So you're just walking off and thinking, how are we 0-0 there? And actually, we only ended up getting beat. They went 2-0 up and you thought, oh, okay. And Mertz, my old mate Mertz, me right back, me wingman, my partner, he said the big beast from Valencia, I think, was it Batista or something? Batista, the beast, they called him. And I remember him bursting sort of away and Mertz went, Glen, it's all right, I've got him. And I went, okay, Mertz, and I turned round and then he was through on goal. And I thought, you ain't got him, Mertz. I think you went down, got a penalty, 2-0. We actually pulled a goal back. And we had a chance, City might have had a chance to equalise. And then you're thinking, but that was the thing with Arsenal, where they could batter you, totally outplay you.
Yeah.
But you always felt, you've got a chance because they'll shoot themselves in the foot or give a stupid goal away, and we might be able to get a result, but they're just the toughest team I've ever played against it in my career.
Yeah, no, I think it's funny though, because when we went, the thing is, I think we were honest, like we would go and try and go toe-to-toe yeah. with anyone. The funny thing is, when I went to Stoke, obviously we knew what we were, a bunch of floggers, and they never beat us.
It's like I said, Kits, go back to that point. If you said, who are we going to get a result? If you were playing a top team, or yeah. say you're in a cup final, and you got to Wembley in a cup final, who do we want? Manchester United, Chelsea, like Mourinho, Chelsea, Sir Alex Ferguson, I'll take Wenger's Arsenal. Even though, in some ways, they played better
yeah.
than the other two, but they do something stupid, and Birmingham did it to them in the cup final. They were 1-0 up, I think, and they made two mistakes at the back, and we even nearly beat them years later, didn't we, in the semi-final at Wembley.
Yeah,
a bit unlucky.
Yeah, yeah.
We nearly did the job on them. So that was just the Wenger Arsenal. But to play against kids, just like, it was just the way they played, the movement, they've just, you just couldn't get near them,
no,
could you?
So
whereas
yeah.
Chelsea were a bit more rigid. You knew the structure. It was Lampard, the midfield, they had that spine, Drogba up front you had to deal with. United, it was just try and stop Rooney and Ronaldo. But it was just Arsenal, just like I said, all those different kickoffs, the night time, daytime, lunchtime, it didn't matter.
Okay.
They beat us every time.
So let's take you back to the beginning, because for the people who don't know. So you started at Palace, and then you made
local lad.
Yeah, and you made that well-trodden move to Glen Torren, like people
did. Yeah.
How did that come about?
I was at Palace, a kid, like local lad, grew up just, and the link is going back. Being born in Wimbledon, it's obvious I was a Manchester United fan. Kids. It was either United or Liverpool. So I chose United. Steve Coppell, growing up, my favourite player. Like the right winger, number 7. And he ended up coming to Palace. Now, I can remember him getting a job, and within a couple of weeks, the school I was at, the Palace Youth Development Officer, he lived opposite on the estate, opposite the school. So I was 9 years old, come in, we want you in. Because back then, you had to start under 11. Now, I think the clubs have them at about 6 years old, it starts at now. So he said, now come in, and Coppell got the Palace job. And he said, come and meet the new manager. I remember taking my pictures in, and he's signing them for me. And then I look back, he was 26. It's just incredible to think that was his first job. He played 44 times for England, and he retired at about 25, yeah, and he played 44 times. So he had, he told me the story, Coppell. It was, I think they played Hungary, and it was a bad challenge, and he could never get back. Like we used to see, he had about, even he was still having operations when he was the manager, kids. But I grew up at Palace, and then schoolboy, then it was in the youth team, and I used to watch him train because I broke my leg when I was 15, 16. I broke my leg twice, I was out for 2 years, so I was just basically the first year apprenticeship I did. I was the dog's body, just getting the bibs and the cones, just to stand and have to move the goals for the first team, get the balls out of the bushes. But he used to train, he could train,
yeah.
But he's like, his career was done, couldn't be the player manager. But it was a bit of sort of the trick question. People would say, who's the best player at Palace? Oh, Ian Wright, no. Mark Bright, no. Jeff Thomas, no. Who? Steve Coppell, because in training he was brilliant, Kits. His delivery. I never really modelled my game on anyone, but the one thing I took from the gaffer was just that delivery. Just not always, sort of, he didn't put that whip on it. It was just always just like feed it in there. Just always seemed to be the right way across, and used to haunt the goalkeepers. And so it was a shame that by the time I then signed for Reading 10 years later, he could hardly run, could he? He didn't take any training. He used to come out with the moon boots on in the tracksuit, and he couldn't even join in the circle with it. So it's a shame the boys never ever got to see him. That I used to see him train, but
when he would come out in his room, comes the gnome.
Here he comes, that dungeon master.
Yeah.
And he used to sort of come out, but like I said, even the circle, Dill, like Kevin Dillon, Dill used to sometimes get involved, and Dill could still play a bit.
Yeah.
But the gaffer, it was a shame you boys never got to see what I saw. But yeah, it was just, he even said to me that, because you'd think, oh, you're a right winger, Glenn. You're playing for a great right winger in Steve Coppell. What advice did he give? You know what he was like? Yeah, he never gave you any advice. He never said, Blinky, I think you should do this. And maybe, and he said to me, how can I give you advice, Blinky? He said, because he was 5'3", I'm 6'3". He was that quick, shifty winger. I'm that slow, like, arms and legs winger. So he said, you just play nothing like me. He said, I just had one trick. I used to sort of run down the wing and sort of stop and go and then knock it with the other foot and cross it. He said, you twist and turn and go inside out. But he never sort of gave you any sort of coaching whatsoever. But that was the man. The best thing about Cops, I felt, was just putting it all together.
Yeah.
Because he never took the training sessions, did he? Left it to Dill and Wally. He never moaned at anyone, never sort of had a screaming match with anyone. He didn't really like the confrontation, but his job was putting that jigsaw puzzle together.
Yeah.
And he did it at Palace, unbelievable. Like, we went up a couple of times in Premier League and FA Cup final. And what he did at Palace, I spoke to Wally once on the coach, and I said, we're exactly the same as that Palace team. You've got Sonko, Eric Young, Ivers, your Andy Fulham. You got your right and bright up front.
Yeah.
I'd say you're the brighty, and Doyle and Lita combined is the Ian Wright. Yeah. Jeff Thomas and Andy Gray is your Sidwell and Harper. Yeah, I'm your Eddie McGoldrick, which probably don't really work out. But it was just, and Wally went, you've only just realised that, Blakey. And I went, no. But that's what he did. He did it again with us.
Yeah. But see, when you're in the middle of it, you don't really notice things like that, because it's, and especially in the Championship, because it's game after game after game, you don't really know, you don't really see sort of the genius behind it, you know, the guy who's sort of tying it all together.
And because he wasn't loud or vocal with it,
he
wasn't like someone in interviews as well, was he? It wasn't all about him.
No, a lot.
He was very sort of take aback. It was just so sort of just. Don't get carried away, which probably helped Kits, because that season, like, you could have got carried away. Like, none of us had really been in the Premier League.
Yeah.
So for us, it was exciting times. I still look back, and it's hard to believe what we did. And if you'd have come down from the Prem, I always felt if someone breaks the record, it would be a team that comes down and just got players on 100, 150 grand a week playing in the Championship. So for us to do it, it was strange, Kits, how... When I look back, no one ever mentioned promotion.
No.
We never mentioned the record. I even think it was only when we won that last game and they said, oh, you've beaten the record. I even sort of knew about it. I was just so happy. Job done. We've got to be in the Premier League.
Until the last game.
No, and it was just the thing that stood out for us was the unbeaten run.
Yeah.
That we thought, don't let this slip now. Once we got it, it was just going on and on. And people will look back, 99 goals. There's so many things you could look at. But not just the 106. The 106 will always stand out because it was a record. And that's what the points you end up with. But that 33 unbeaten run in the Championship, we were up and down sort of the motorway. It's Saturday, Tuesday. And the pitches, they're not as good as what they are now. No. So you're having to scrap and battle in games. And the season, my first season when I signed, we got up to 8 games unbeaten. And we went to Coventry, Highfield Road, we lost 3-2. And I can remember thinking, 8 games, that's all right. That's not bad. We got to 8. And then the next season, it's 33. And I think I got told, I did a media interview after the game up at Hull. I scored a header. Didn't score many headers. But I scored a header up at Hull. We drew 1-1 and... The press said, Glenn, that's 14 games unbeaten. Now you're in a good run of form. And 14? That's all right. And then it was 20, and then it was 25. And for all the games, Kits, to get to 33, your first away defeat as well didn't come till middle of February. And unheard of. And it was just by the time we got the 33, by the time we lost, it was, now we're about 15 clear.
Yeah,
we're pretty much up. Anyway,
but that's the thing, because we could have. I remember us having a meeting saying we've got to go from now to the end of the season.
Wally said it, didn't he? When we lost, Wally said we don't lose again.
Yeah.
And we didn't. Nah. And even that game, Kits, like we'll go through a lot of the games I'd have thought that season because it was so special, and we'll have the standout games. But we went up to, again, it's obviously in my mind because it was Valentine's Day, so it stands out. With the Sheffield United, we went up there and we knew this is the game. If we win here, because I was always the one, unlucky. I'd had 2 7th place finishes with Burnley. I lost on goal difference one when it was the first season. They brought goal difference in and goal scored. Then the first season at Reading, we're up there the whole season. The very first game of the season when we beat Brighton at home, we were in the playoffs. Until the final whistle went at Wigan, we lost the last three games. We only needed a point, we'd have been in. So I was always, we can't blow this. But I thought that Sheffield United game, if we win here, you can't convince another. We are up, and it was 1-1, and we got a penalty. And who do you want taking it? You scored every penalty that season, and you missed. And so I thought, oh, kids, I know it's 1-1, but. Yeah, if we'd have scored those 2 points, we would have been up. And I don't know as well. We drove home, but the M1 was shut, and we had to cut through. And everyone might not know, but one of the players' nicknames, Marcus, his nickname was Buddy. Yeah. And we went past this sort of American sort of cafe called Buddy's USA, and this sort of, it was a night game, so it was 1 o'clock in the morning. And 45 minutes later, we go back past it, and someone said, "Hang a minute, there's that Buddy's again." Surely there can't be two of them. And never the coach driver, we had to come off, he's gone the wrong way. We end up back at the M1 an hour later. No, this M1's closed. So we didn't get back to about 3 in the morning. And they put us live on Sky on the Friday night against Luton.
Yeah.
And that, I think it was a Sheffield United game. That was a big game. It was a win when it was tough up there. And they threw everything at us that game. We sort of hung on, did well, and got the 1-1. And then that Luton game was just, that was the, and I missed the game. Me and City missed the game, but we had to travel. We had a late fitness test, me and City out, you don't want to go to Kenilworth Road and have nowhere to sit. Well, you don't want to play there, let alone, but have to go then. You're not even playing. Where are we going to go, City? And I think it was Chris Coyne, the Luton captain, he wasn't playing. He said, "No, boys, come with me. There's the greenhouse on the far side. We're all going." So we went through a couple of people's homes, went through a back garden, through the kitchen, and then we turn up at the greenhouse on the far side. And as soon as we walk in there, we hear, "Goal!" What? One of the Luton boys. We look, Doyle scored after about 25 seconds. And everyone, there was about 6 Luton boys in there with me and City, and they all looked at us and went, "Well, that's game over." And me and City went, "Yeah." And because you know what we were like that season, we took the lead, it was game over. But then all credit to Luton, they turned it round, and maybe it was that Sheffield United game run out of steam.
Yeah,
kicks, and that was the end of the run, wasn't it?
So let's start at the beginning of the season, because the question that does come up, and I might preempt it already for the Q&A after this, but somebody asked me, and Leeds separately, what was the game when you knew you had something? And I'd just be interested because for us it was quite early.
I'll start off with the season, because this is a classic, kids. We had the bad finish, didn't we? Where three games. I think it was Cardiff away, Wolves at home, and Wigan away. You're thinking a point, and we're in the playoffs.
Yeah.
And we lost all three. And that Wigan game, they were. Won promotion, celebrating in front of us. That hurt. I can remember that coach journey home, kids. We actually went out. We were in Windsor. We used to, end of the season, you have your night out, don't you, all the boys. And yet we all sat there at the table in Vanilla Bar in Windsor, and everybody you couldn't enjoy yourself. We were saying, and then you're blaming Lloyd. Lloyd and Dean Morgan. Yeah, blaming Les Ferdinand. Blaming Martin Keown, because again, if you followed us, that's that free kick we had. We used to have a shout that we go back for a free kick on the edge of the box. They take a free kick, and we used to say, "Pick up Baz." One of the boys, "Pick up Baz, pick up Baz." And what that meant, as soon as they take the free kick, everyone runs out and you catch them offside. It did work quite well, kids. And what you hoped, even like Marcus would come and catch it in front out, and you've got sort of 6 against 2 at the back. And we had the pick up Baz, and Martin Keown at Cardiff, we all run out after 10 minutes. He's the one that stays in. Most experienced player, Arsenal, England, and then they score. And so that was Martin Keown got the blame. Celez, lovely man.
Yeah.
Like you loved him, kids, like Tottenham fan. Lovely man, but had an absolute disaster.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we blame Les and blame Martin. And so, yeah, it was the worst night out you've ever had because we just said, how are we not in the playoffs? We were up there the whole season, third at Boxing Day. We beat Watford Live and Sky 3-0 and everything was going well. And so you come back the next season thinking, hopefully we're up there again. And then all of a sudden, Foz goes, all the experienced players left. Foz and Ricky Newman, Lloyd left. And then you think, okay, we'll be signing players. And we signed Kevin Dorman, Shane Long from Cork. Well, what are they going to do? Help us win the reserve league and put the bibs and cones out. So we went back and I was even thinking, there was a bit of a chat. We had a meeting amongst them. As the chairman, has he got the ump? Because he paid good money to Les Fernand, Martin Keown. It went wrong. Has he sort of got the ump now?
Yeah.
And is he sulking? He's not even going for it because we only had about 14 players' kits. You had trialists turn up, and you're thinking, well, they're not going to do anything. And then all of a sudden, we signed Leeward for $1 million. Well, where's that come from? So, but even then, Leeward only played League One. It wasn't, this is someone you'd lost Foz, who you had a good partnership with Foz kits. Foz for the championship, we know the pace. Foz did great for the club, but I don't know what happened with him and Cox, but there was something not quite right. So he let Foz go. So, okay, we signed, but we're going to need more than that. And then we start the season. You lose, you're thinking Plymouth, that's the win to get you up and running. And you lose in the last minute. And I was actually in TGI's with the family. I walk in the toilet and I can hear two Reading fans talking about the game. And I'm sat there having a piss. Well, I'm stood there having a piss. And then I'm hoping they don't say anything. And I turn round and then they say, not good today, Glenn, is it? And I went, nah, it wasn't. And they said, I don't think Steve Coppell's the right man, is he? And I went, nah, you're probably right. how wrong were we? But we even had, if you remember, Kitch, we went down to Brighton. We had two sort of away games. Brighton, you think, horrible place to go, the running track. And then up at Preston, who had been a bit of a nemesis for us, Preston up there. So you're thinking we could be sort of three defeats here to start the season. And we got called in the afternoon. Usually you have a bit of a sleep. And we got called into the sort of hotel sort of meeting room and the gaffer weren't even there. And it was Wally and Dill. And Wally basically sort of said, we've got to win here today, boys.
Yeah.
And we knew, we're under pressure already. And then we beat Brighton, it we good win there. Me and you, Kits. Me and you, Kits, got off on the score sheet.
Same old.
Went up to Preston, and that was Leroy's first big impact where you thought we might have a finisher here.
Yeah.
Again, similar, like Coppell said, he was hoping he could be like an Ian Wright, and that was like Leroy had the two good fit. And Convey had a struggle the first season, $850,000. He came in. First training session, this might be $900,000 too much at this point. when we set up the pattern of play, because we hadn't moved into the new training ground, we're up at the Bradfield College, and I remember I'm on the right, we're doing the pattern of play against the back four, and he kept trying to take Mertz on, and Mertz was just taking off every time, and I'm looking at him, this boy kept losing it, and he didn't have a good first season. But then he set up the two goals, and one of them, the ball for Leroy, was the pass of the season with a great ball over the top. Leroy finishing and 3-0, and you think, okay, that's all right. We lost up there because when that was the start of the slide of the first season, we went up there. I just mentioned we beat Watford 3-0 on the box today. We went up to Preston and got beat 3-0, and it was the only time the gaffer was angry. Because they were 1-0 up, and I actually took a corner, it got headed out, and they cleared it, and Convey was back, he had it covered. And Eddie Lewis tripped him up, and they crossed it to Eddie Lewis, he scored 2-0, ref didn't give it, Convey's back on the halfway line on the floor, and they were good mates from the USA. And Coppell came in, he said, remember that, he's your mate, and he was, after the game, he was laughing, Eddie Lewis, because he tripped him off the ball. And that was the only time I really saw it. And he said, remember that. And then we went up there that season. So we owed them. There was a few teams we owed.
Yeah.
That was one of them. And I'm sure we'll get to one a bit later on.
Yeah.
And then that was okay, 3-0. We're all right now. We're up and running.
And that's what Lee said as well. That Preston game was the game where I thought, all right, not many teams go to Preston.
No.
I batter them.
Yeah.
And it's one of only it's only happened twice in my career where I've been a part of a team walking off and the home fans have clapped.
Yeah,
Do you remember?
Yeah, they did. And for me as well, being Burnley, that was always a big game for me,
yeah.
Preston. I had plenty of battles in my Burnley days with them and I scored another header. What was I doing scoring headers? I don't know. I only scored five in my whole career. But I actually scored a header and that was a great win, that kit, to take the pressure off us. And okay, and then I still don't think we were firing in all cylinders, kits.
Yeah.
It took us another 8 or 9 games, and then there was a couple of wins. The Palace win, I'm not just saying that you weren't playing. Did you get injured, kits?
I got injured. I can't actually remember.
But because it was then Doyle came on. You started with Leroy, didn't you? And then Doyle came in, and you thought, hey, this boy, he just. Strong runner. The game, I don't know whether you thought this about Doyle, but the pre-season he come in, him and Shane, do you remember the first transfer when we just did a circle? Everyone knows they call it the rondo. If you do a circle, which is basic, you could get a non-league player just to do it. If you're even struggling, just give it to the man next to you. Longy, he just kept going in the middle and he kept giving it away. He got sent off after a week. He got sent back with the youth team.
Yeah.
He was terrible, Longy. out of all the players I played with in my career, I always believe you've either got it or you haven't.
Yeah.
Like you've got a football brain or you haven't. Yes, you can improve your fitness. You can go in the gym. Yeah, you can get bigger and stronger. But you can't improve your ability. It's natural, the talent. Longy's the exception to the rule because the improvement he made, it was incredible.
They,
and he had a great career, well.
But Wally and Eamon, I think, and probably even Steve, and they worked with him. At least one of them worked with him every single day.
Yeah.
Every single day after. I wish they were.
Because he had sort of the attributes, again, like he was a strong boy, but he was just so warm. Like, you pass the ball, he'd run into you. And you think, well, what are you doing? And like I said, he couldn't even do the circle properly. But with Doyle, we went to Sweden and we played this game and we never did this because we were 4-4-2. But this game in Sweden, we played a 4-3-3. And I was on the left, Doyle on the right, Leroy through the middle. And it was one of the stronger games because we had some games in Sweden where we played the village team. It was embarrassing.
Yeah.
We had a ridiculous game where we won about 20-0. We had another ridiculous game where we drove about 2 hours and we got there. It wasn't even a stadium. It was a field, like a village field. And it was our first game out there. And do you remember this, Kits, where after half an hour we were 0-0 and we had Dolly and Leeds up front, £1 million, and we were playing this village team.
Yeah.
And it was 0-0 after half an hour. And I remember thinking, oh, this is terrible, this. And another standout from that game, me and Shorey had come on, and Shorey tried to take on, we called him Billy Bunter, this big boy. Shorey tried to take him on, and he lost the ball. And that's when we thought, Shorey ain't right here. He still had a knee problem. Shorey struggling. And it was just a terrible friendly. But then we played against one of the team in a proper stadium. And I remember Doyle had a couple of runs where I'm watching from the far side, the ball goes over and I'm thinking he's not going to get there. And he had that run where he was like running, you think he's at full pace, and then he could go again and get another yard. And I thought, so straight from then, that's when I thought, this boy, he might have something here, that strong running boy. I think it helped as well that Ireland did the Summer League. So they started in March.
Yeah.
So we cut turn up 2 months off and then he's there, hitting the ground running, he's fit.
Yeah.
And then he come in, like you have to say, what a find from Doyle. Because the first season I was here, when you got injured, kids, that's when we had the back. We had no one that would score, did we?
Yeah.
And like Foz was out of favour, you got injured, and we went about 13 games without a win until the West Ham game, one of your favourites, at the hat-trick where we battered West Ham, Pards came back and we battered West Ham. And so you're thinking, if you'd have been out, if Doyle hadn't stepped up, like we would have been struggling, but we just really, like we got it going. Like I said, I didn't think we were firing on all cylinders. And then all of a sudden, we had the Palace game, one of my favourites, 3-2. Again, always nice for me, being sort of a youngster at Palace that got released. And then the game I thought that, because I still didn't believe it, kids. No, we were on the unbeaten run, because I thought, we've had this before, well, I've been up there, I'd had 2 sevenths at Burnley, I'd signed for Reading, I had another seventh when we should have made the playoffs. The one, like, no, when you said, when did you really think we'd beaten Ipswich at home live on the Sky, and it was 2-0, we should have beaten them about 7, and we didn't half play well. And I thought, that's a good win, because Ipswich, again, similar to Preston, always usually up there in the playoffs, bit of a marker team. And then it was a strange fixture list. Now, we had him about 4 games later. We had to go then to Portman Road. And after 20 minutes, we should have been 5 up, and we'd missed chance after chance, had a goal disallowed. And I'm thinking to myself, we could rue those misses there. Yeah. And then City finally scored, and then we ran out 3-0 winners. And I've been in the championship a long time, plenty of times I've been to Portman Road. No one had done that to Ipswich, where it was 3-0, it should have been 8 or 9. And Joe Wall said after the game, it was probably one of our best away performances, I think, that one. Like, we were outstanding that night. And Joe Wall said after the game, that's one of the best championship teams. And Joe Wall, experienced manager, had promotion. Yeah, he had some good sides in the championship. Yeah. And he said, they're one of the best I've seen. They've got pace, they've got power, they've got experience, they've got some good young players. He just said, they got everything. And what I remember most on the way home, we used to get the fish and chips sort of finished. We were sort of in that era. It used to be fish and chips, get the beers on the coach. Then it was sort of changing, where all of a sudden it became the pasta meals. Yeah, they used to get microwave oven. They had oven on the coach, yeah. And then so it was, okay, you're getting pasta. And we went, they said, no, as a bit of a treat, John Goodman and the gaffer there said, can you have a bit of a treat? We stopped at this retail park just out of Ipswich, and there was a KFC, Burger King, McDonald's, and you just see boys scattered all over this retail park, like 12 o'clock at night, yeah, just getting all these like bargain buckets, the Burger King, the Whoppers, the Big Macs, I had all 3. And you know what I'm like eating, kids. So, and that was the feel-good fact as well, where they gave us a treat, and there was just, with like fast food all the way home. That they're the memories, that the away wins. Like, people always say to me, what's your best, like your memories? And I did play for quite a long time, so you have your favourite games and the players you played with, your outstanding seasons. But there's nothing better than the night game, like that long journey on the coach when you've won away from home tips, and you're buzzing, and you're top. Like, no, when we were flying and we knew it, and so that was when I thought, this might be different. Like, we're a fucking good side here.
Yeah.
And then that Ipswich, no one does that to Ipswich, and then the next game that stands out. This is where I thought, we're going to do it. This is where. There was 2 more where I thought, this is us now. Another revenge game on Boxing Day up at Wolves, where, again, you missed at Wolves the season before, Kits. You might not know the story, because we had Lloyd and Morgs up front, I think. Or yeah.
I remember getting...
Morgs actually scored, or did you...
No, I think I was injured.
Oh, you got injured, And we were 1-0 down. The season before, we were 1-0 down. And you know the gaffer always sits up in the stand in the first half. Yeah. And we come in at half time, and he done his team talk. And I was thinking to myself, I can't believe, because I do talk a lot, but I never mentioned anything. But I was thinking to myself, this doesn't sound right to me. And in the end, it was someone who speaks probably more than me, like our mate Harper. And Arps went, what do you think the score is, gaffer? And he went, 1-0. We went, that's 2-0. They scored right at half time. And he went, oh, I was in the lifter. Now, Now, Al, you're in the lift, whether it was a soundproof lift, but you must have heard 30,000 at Molyneux cheering a goal. And he went, oh, we're 2-0. Oh, well, don't forget what I said. Just go out there and get on with it. So we actually got beat 4-1 that game. And even though they were teammates, Hoddle was the much bigger name, wasn't he? And I think Hoddle was a bit, it's all about me. Gaffer was reserved. I don't think they were best buddies, considering like they'd had good careers and Hoddle had the swagger, that sort of arrogance about him, and so that hurt. I think that hurt the gaffer. So we went there, and they beat us in the playoffs. When the first time I ever came to Reading on loan, that they beat us in the playoffs, and we were a better team for 180 minutes. We probably dominated 160 of those playoffs, and we lost both games. Yeah. And then they cost us when they came. They were mid-table and we only needed the draw. And Foz scored early. Foz scored a great goal, volley in the top corner. And you're thinking, look, okay, we've got to be in the post. They turn it around, but it's 2-1. They beat us 4-1 as well. Mind you, we went there and it was probably my best assist kiss of my career. And you scored the first goal.
Yeah, tell me how you won the ball back.
Oh, well, I fell over. It was the only tackle I ever made, but we went there, and the Coppell had said in the press, even though they were about 20 points behind, he said, we're playing well, too many draws, but we're going to give someone a hiding. And he also said, Reading, they've been up there before, they've blown it. He was like doing the talk, and we went, okay, yeah, he's got every right to do the talk because Wolves have had our number. And they had some big players like Darren Anderton and Les Guy at the back, wasn't it? And Colin Cameron, I think, and Alex Ray, people like that. And so we went there. First minute, I actually put one on for Kitson. You headed it at the bar. I came down. You headed it again at the bar. We couldn't believe it. And you think it should have been 1-0 up in the first minute. Yeah. But I actually made a tackle on Lescott, but I had to make it because I actually played Mertz down the line and I give it away. Lescott, I'm thinking, what's he doing over there? Like, when you think you're out on the touchline and he's tackling our right back and he took it off Mertz. I thought, oh, Mertz is going to hammer me here. So I better make a tackle. I didn't make many, but I made the tackle and then I went past about 8 of them down the right wing. And then I turned back, went past a few more, and then I actually crossed it. But if you actually see that goal, Kitts, I thought Doyley was going to head it in. He was stood there just to head it in the empty net. But you've come a great header because you've made the run. You were running at full pace, which weren't quick, but
it was quick enough.
Let's stop with that enough. But then you come with a header. And I actually came off that game because I got the nailer, caught me on the knee, split my knee open. I had 5 stitches. I usually tell the story about 68 stitches. Yeah. Like, I'm a tough man, and I was back a week later, but it was only 5 stitches. And I remember coming off, and I had to go in their medical room, and their doctor was coming in, and he was stitching up, and Hoddle came in, and he even said, "Is he coming off?" And I went, "You're lucky I am." But we went on to win the game, and that was another win where you're thinking it's different here.
The needle between the gaffer and Hoddle was that after they beat us that time, Hoddle didn't ask Gaffer to go into the manager's room for a glass of wine. And it's like, that's a big no. The only other manager that did that to him was Arsene Wenger.
Yeah, Wenger. The arrogance one, I know.
Yeah.
But that was strange, though. I always thought with Coppell that, like maybe you just missed out on that, the real golden years of football, and you don't realise how good he was, Kitts. Because for 44 caps, and that was when you played the proper games, there wasn't all these stupid friendlies and these qualifiers where you're playing Liechtensteins and Estonians and things like that. But you just always thought Hoddle just like rated himself, where the gaffer, that was never him to big himself up, was it?
No. It's only,
keep your feet on the floor.
All Steve demanded was respect. That's the only thing he ever asked for, was a bit of respect.
Yeah.
So quickly, get through to the end of the season. I haven't got to the Premier League.
We went on about another 20 unbeaten run, and then we went up with the record. But no, it was just... It was just a season that it was hard to believe because it meant so much to us. because we never had the big names. There was no big time Charlies other than me and you, was
there?
Exactly.
So
so it was just we're all in it together. We're all desperate. I know for me as well. Like you were a younger kid, so you had time in your career. I knew this was my last chance. I've been at Burnley for sort of 8 years trying to get in the trying to win promotion. I had about four or five clubs to choose from when I was at a free transfer, and I chose Reading. I thought we had a chance. You'd never dream it's going to be, but just, yeah, the memories, just on and off the field. We were living, it was like a dream. You're living the dream, kids, weren't you? And and then, yeah, we lost at Luton. We mentioned it with Wally, but we won't lose again. And we didn't. I think that shows probably just the type of characters we had, the professionalism. I look at that team we had, the most professional bunch. Now, training started 10:30. I was always one of the latest out because I was always in the treatment room, which isn't a surprise, with Fernie, like doing like the strappings. And I used to get out at 10:15 and newcomers to the circle. Like the circle's already been going 20 minutes. You had those like harps would be out there at about 7:15 winning pinging balls. And that was on his day off. But it was just like the work ethic. And it was definitely that hunger because we all knew we had to get to the Premier League. None of us had played this. We all in it together. And it was just all how it happened. Just that game against Leicester. Just there and going up. The realisation we're going to be in the Premier League. And then the game against Derby. That was a proper pitch invasion. That was actually allowed back then.
It was actually you that... So when we came off the pitch at Leicester, we didn't know because there was another result
I
had to go.
I was doing the commentary. I was injured.
So
kicks.
None of us
And like, what happened, we were 1-0 down. Leeds, I think, were 1-0 up. So we didn't even think about going up. Yeah. And then all of a sudden, Doyley scored that 5 minutes to go. And then there was a last minute at Leeds, and it was like Tim Della was with me. No, like Leeds, like they're 1-1 now, but we're up. So it was just, I don't know whether that was a good thing or not, kids. I don't know. It was just, but it was a surprise. Now, I would never give up that season because of the record points, and it was just such a special season. But there wasn't an excitement to going up. Was there? Because we sort of knew from February this we were already up, so we didn't have that. Oh, like we've got to go last game of the season, whatever, at home to QPR. We've got to win to go up. There was no pressure. It was just okay. Yeah, we're up, and it seems strange how the season was going on, and it was Reading weren't taking part in the Championship anymore. No one was bothered about our games. Like, we were still playing. It was all about the playoff teams and the relegation, and it was as if we weren't even taking part. Our season was done. Yeah. And then it was just the excitement of getting that fixture list, wasn't it?
But along with that, on that sort of theme as well, on this day, when we sort of, so we got the points, broke the record, and no one, there was nothing organised. There was nothing, no one really knew what was, something we went up, didn't we? And
yeah.
We had a bit of a wave.
Went up, Derby, when everyone was on the pitch, because... I'm going to tell you a story. It's a bit dirty, but because I do eat a lot, the amount of shits I used to have before the games where you're having the chicken and the pasta and the beans and the scrambled eggs and so you get to the game, it's the Lucasades or the Powerade, and then you've got the Red Bull and it's just, my slips that we used to wear... they used to say they were like the white and brown striped slips where everyone else is just white. So after every game, it was a bit of a laugh and a joke. When it look at each other, I feel bad for Big Rum doing the kit, having to put my slips in at the end. And then at the end, we're up on the balcony and people like throwing the shirts off, and I threw my slips off, and someone caught them and waved them, and all the boys up on the balcony laughing, and he looked at them. So. Yeah, that was what I remember from the Derby game. But yeah, we were just up on the balcony, and then the last game, I can't even remember what we'd done. We had that. Then there was the bus round the town.
Yeah.
We did the bus round the town, and there was a dinner. There was a promotion dinner. Can't really remember too much of it. I think the chairman organised a promotion dinner.
McDonald's.
No, it was at the club. Yeah, there might have been maybe an Elvis personator there. Yeah. So well, here's one. We'll tell everyone about the bonuses. Because our bonuses, I think, for going up with the raffle points, we got about £8.50 each, didn't we? Yeah. And that was the boys who had the extra bonus, wasn't it, in their contracts, that the bonus was shocking. And it carried on, so people weren't happy with the bonuses. And we said, we're not going to the chairman's dinner, do you remember? And he said, if you don't go, there'll be repercussions. And he put the threat on, because it carried over to the next season. And...
Yeah.
Another short. I remember getting a call one of the players. I was at Wrexham at the time, and one of the boys said, "Glen, have you read The Secret Footballer?" And I went, "No, I'm not a bookman, Kits. Yeah, I've read about two books in my whole life." And I went, "No, what is it?" And they said, "Yeah, you might know him." So he told me the story. Right, so I just had a quick flick through, and one of the stories I realised was the team photo story. And I thought, hang on a minute. I said, that's Reading. That was our team photo. And then what gave you away, I looked for a few bits, and it said, when we used to play Edson's in the car park at the back of the ground, and it was like lower league player, and I thought, at Cambridge, you come into the car park and you have to walk to the far end for the dressing rooms, kids, don't you? Yeah. At the back of the ground, they've got the car park and sort of playing Edson's. And I thought, that's at Cambridge in the car park. So I thought, that's Kits. That was Reading. And so I haven't just given your secret away, Kits, have I? No, it's not really, Kits. I'm stitching them up here. But so it carried on to the next season. And then we said, if we don't get this sorted, because Nicky Hammond came out to the Sweden to try and sort it. And he went through the figures, and we went, no. Everyone was like looking at him, you are joking. No, we're not signing it. So it carried on further into pre-season, and then the season just about to start. They had the team photo. We were all at the training ground, and they said, right, we've got to sign these bonus forms soon, because the season's going to start once it... So this is our last chance to make a stand. We're not having the team photo done.
Yeah.
And so me, Sonks, and... people went down to the dressing room.
We
stayed behind you. You go down there, because Nicky Hammond's down there. Go down to the ground, but nobody get changed. Yeah. Go down the ground, see what Nicky Hammond says. And in the end, me, Sonks and Ivor just said, look, the gaffer, don't like the confrontation, didn't want to get involved. But we went in his office and we said, gaffer, you've got to get involved now. We've got to sort this. This isn't on. It's like scandalous, really, the figures. And... we had a chat with him. So we're on the way down. Siddy's down there talking to Hammond. Siddy, we're on the way down. We spoke to Gaffer. He's going to get involved now. But whatever you do, nobody sort of get changed. Nobody on the pitch. All right, Glen, I'm with Hammo now. Okay, we're on our way down. We get down there. There's one person on the pitch.
Yeah.
The skipper.
Yeah.
Not saying any names. But he's the skipper. So we're looking. He's buzzing as well. We're like, what is he doing? But we managed to sort it. But I did think, I still was a bit surprised when I saw the book and you said, I never spoke to him. I never really noticed that though. Kits, after that, I lost all respect for him. For Mertz. I never noticed that at the time. I just thought, like, it is Mertz. He is a bit busy. For some reason, it's these fullbacks, right backs are busy. I don't know why. That was what happened. So it wasn't a great start to the season, really. Because they said, we can't do the figures because the contract's already done, the season finished. We'll put it in the Premier League season, which they didn't really at the time. And then did we say, well, just buy everyone a watch, like a nice watch, sort of buy all the squad a watch and staff. And they wouldn't even do that, did they? It would have cost about £150,000 to buy all the staff a watch, and they wouldn't do that. So it wasn't a good sort of start to the season.
It was messy. I remember that time being quite messy. But we've overrun, unsurprisingly. It's up to you, after we have a 15-minute break for a pee and whatever Glen wants to do in there, and a beer.
Number two.
And then it's up to you guys with the Q&A to ask him about the Premier League years.